Welcome and thank you for joining us today. My name is Mary Price. I'm the Events and Marketing Director at the Shingo Institute at Utah State University. Today, I'm excited to have Katie Anderson with us. Katie is an internationally recognized leadership consultant, coach, professional speaker, and learning enthusiast, dedicated to helping leaders create cultures of learning and accelerate individual and organizational impact. She is also a Shingo Publication Award recipient for her book, Learning to Lead, Leading to Learn, and she's also keynoting at this year's Shingo Conference on May 9th and 10th in Orlando, Florida. If you subscribe to her monthly newsletter, Katie wrote an article that was published yesterday with the same title as today's webinar. If you don't subscribe to the newsletter, I would encourage you to do so, but you can also find the article on our website. Simply go to shingo.org, click the media tab, and select the blog. I would encourage you to read this when you have a few moments. As a reminder, all of our monthly webinars can be found on our Shingo YouTube channel. You can access that from our website. It's just under the media tab and click videos. And with that, Katie, I'll turn the time over to you.
Thanks, Mary. Great to have all of you here today. And to talk about not only how do we harness the power of people, but what is a leader's purpose and an organization's purpose doing that? So please, if you haven't already, answer the poll, because we're going to come back to that in a moment, midway through our conversation here today. So to kick us off, I want to take a moment and have you think about a time in your life when you were just starting a new job, you know, maybe in your late teens or early 20s, and you've been assigned, in this case, to do one simple task: to pour a can of paint and a can of solvent into a big vat. And as the cars, because you're working at a car manufacturer, go down the line, this paint mixture will be sprayed onto the paint. And this is what your first assignment is, your first professional job. So you're a little nervous and excited at the same time. And, you know, honestly, it's a little boring at times too, but easy, right? Well, one day, someone comes running into the shop floor from one of the managers from the front line and says, "Stop, we have to stop the line. 100 cars have to be repainted. The paint's literally dripping off the cars." And all eyes go on you. This was your responsibility. What would happen to you if this was you at your first job? Would someone have yelled at you, blamed you, maybe gotten mad or frustrated and angry? Maybe you would even been fired. I mean, this was in the first month of your probationary period at work. Well, this is not what happened for Isao Yoshino when he joined Toyota Motor Corporation back in the late 1960s. And this is the same situation that happened for countless others who made mistakes in their work, either in their first weeks and months as they were learning or later down the line. And this about how a leader responds to mistakes and how they create the conditions for people to be successful is the foundation of a leader's purpose in creating a culture of continuous improvement. And I'm going to share something with you later today that's even more astounding and such a simple shift that we all can make as well. But Isao Yoshino's leaders did not come and yell at him. In fact, they did the opposite. They came over and walked, they walked over to him and said, "Show us the process that you poured the can of paint and the can of solvent into the same vat." And so he held them up and you know, walked over nervously and showed them. And it became very apparent that they looked nearly identical. The writing and the coloring was almost the same. And they said, "It was so easy for you to make this mistake. This was not your fault." And then they worked together right then and there to put some mistake proofing in place. I want you to hold that with you, because if we think about a leader's role and purpose and how we harness the power of people, this culture of psychological safety and this foundation of how we lead with respect for individuals and how we respond to mistakes and problems and challenges is vital for everything else. I had the opportunity to get to know Isao Yoshino 9 years ago when I moved to Japan with my family. And as a continuous improvement practitioner and learning enthusiast and a lean having come from being an internal lean and continuous improvement consultant in healthcare, and then having my own consulting practice, I was really excited about going to the source and learning about the Japanese culture and Toyota culture. And of course, talking to Isao Yoshino, who had worked at Toyota Motor Corporation for 40 years. In fact, he had played some really important roles behind the scenes in helping Toyota create its culture of continuous learning. And I had this one question for him that I was really interested in exploring. It actually became the foundation of the book, Learning to Lead, Leading to Learn. I kept saying, what is the secret to Toyota? And he said, there is no secret. And then one day he said, maybe the only secret to Toyota is its attitude towards learning. And this is what I want you to hold with you, this attitude towards learning and a focus on people. And this links back to the Shingo principles as well. It's about how do we really harness the power of people and their thinking and create a culture where an attitude towards learning is pervasive. At Toyota, they have this motto, and it's not just hung on the wall. It is really clear that this goes through everything that they do. And again, this is not all about Toyota, but I want to use Toyota as an example because it is also the foundation of all the stories in my book and also shows us even present day today, how we can keep learning from them about how do we really create these cultures of continuous improvement and how do we adjust that for our own cultures as well. So at Toyota, they have a saying, mono zukuri wa hito zukuri, which means we make people so we can make things. And other mottos that truly do hang on the wall, such as good products come from good thinking. And this is not just, though, things on the wall. This is what they really believe as the foundation of the culture. But even culture has to be paid attention to intentionally because we can go astray. We have this constancy of purpose, but we can lose sight of purpose. And we often get it backwards here in the US and in other Western countries. And even in Japan, it's possible that companies get it backwards too. Instead of focusing on people first, we support and develop people so that we can make our product or our service, so we can make things. We have it backwards. We focus on results or profit or outcomes that we need. So the outputs, not the inputs. And we have this backwards. I'd be really curious to see what the poll results are here about how you here describe what leaders in your organization would say would be the most important core essence of your purpose. The majority here said making a product or service. Some said creating a product. Some said developing people. Others said maximizing shareholder value. And a few said others. You know, there's it's almost half and half, this creating profit and maximizing shareholder value. This is what we have it backwards. We need to develop people so that we can make a product or service. The output is profit. The output is maximizing shareholder value. But if we focus on those as the core purpose, we will not truly be able to harness the power of people to continue to innovate, thrive, and create this culture that's going to be able to bring us forward into the future. And this even happened to Toyota. So I want to fast forward to today and then link it back to the stories in my book from Mr. Yoshino's experiences from the 60s to the early 2000s to show that this requires intentional focus from us at all times about how do we really come back to creating an organization's culture that focuses on people so that we can create value for our customers, the products or services we deliver, and the result, the output of that is shareholder value, is profit, and more. But we can't focus on the output. We have to focus on the input. In fact, there's a leader that I really admire and actually is considered the sensei of a lot of Japanese executives and Toyota executives included. And he wrote a book called Tree Ring Management. And in that, he said, profit is excrement. It's the natural byproduct of a healthy functioning organization that's focusing on its people and creating excellent products and services. So if we go into the three insights of organizational excellence from the Shingo model, if we want results, we have to focus on behavior and purpose and systems drive that behavior. And then the principles inform that ideal behavior. And behavior starts with us as leaders and as people working in the organization. And this is true for the senior executive too. I was reading some articles this weekend, and I really wanted to bring this into this conversation here because they're so current and showing how even Toyota can make mistakes. But if you come back to that constancy of purpose and focus on we make people so we can make cars or so we can make things or the product or service we deliver, we will be able to succeed truly. So Akio Toyoda, Toyota's current chairman and former president, just a few weeks ago at the end of January made some comments. He actually did this at Toyota's, the foundation of Toyota's company at the former site of the automatic loom works. And he was talking to executives and to the press about how he's going to lead Toyota into the future. And he made a comment that somewhere along the way, we turned into a company that prioritizes volumes and profits, a company that makes money, not cars. He was acknowledging that they had gotten it backwards. And this is because leaders had forgotten about that real constancy of Toyota's purpose. And he said that that's when he believes that Toyota Motor Corporation really collapsed. And this was in the last 14 years. And he's trying to figure out how to right the organization. And he said, really, the right way forward is going back to the company's starting point, to its original purpose, and fixing what's gone wrong in our character. So we need to go back to those ideal behaviors, those principles that guide us, and not lose sight of that it's the inputs, not the outputs, that we need to focus on. And it's about, as many of you said, engaging honestly and earnestly with monozokuri, the making things, the creating value for your customers, and focusing on people and people's creativity and innovation as the way to get there. I was really interested to learn from Mr. Yoshino, and I describe this throughout the book, Learning to Lead, Leading to Learn, that about every 20 years, Toyota has found that they have had to do what Mr. Yoshino calls retightening the belt. And this is about retightening the belt on the culture and the leadership behaviors that they consider are essential to really having this high-performing culture of continuous improvement, or what we call lean today. So there are some examples of this. Back in the 1970s, Mr. Yoshino was involved in this program about reteaching the 1,000 top Toyota senior managers the key behaviors that they considered essential for really being able to drive forward this high performance in organizations, focusing on not just what do they need to achieve for the organization from a result standpoint, but how are they engaging and developing their people and developing themselves at the same time. Again, in the late 1990s and early 2000s, Toyota put out a document called the Toyota Way 2001. And this was Toyota's attempt, again, about 20 years later, to retighten the belt and codify the culture and behaviors that they believed were really important. And now if you fast forward again 20 years, this is Akio Toyoda's attempt at retightening the belt once again and focusing on what are those core behaviors for leaders to will really create the outputs that they need. So don't focus on the profit. It's not about making money. It's about making the things and focusing on people so that you can make the things. And this goes back to then a leader's purpose and the core behaviors that really drive this. And throughout the book, Learning to Lead, Leading to Learn, this all came back to the essence of something that Mr. Yoshino said on stage when he was talking with his former direct report, John Shook. Some of you might know John Shook as the former president of the Lean Enterprise Institute and current president of the Lean Global Network, and someone who has really brought forward how we bring the socio-technical aspects of Lean and the Toyota production system and the Toyota way into the Western world. And they were on stage talking about their role as manager and direct report. And Mr. Yoshino said something that really struck me quite profound, but so simple. And in the back, you know, there I was at the conference, I was scribbling on my notepad. And he said something along the line saying, my role, my purpose as a manager was to give John or whomever was reporting to him a mission or target, and then support him while he figured out how to reach that target. And as I was supporting John and developing John, I was aware I was developing myself as well. And I realized, wow, this is like the essence of what a leader's purpose really is, to create the conditions for people to be successful and to be aligned and to be continuing to create the conditions for ourselves to grow and learn and develop too. So a leader's purpose, if we bring it back to the essence, the roles and the things we need to do to create the conditions in our organization that will result in that the output is, one, set the direction. Where do we need to go? Two, provide support. And three, develop yourself. And I've come to call this leading to learn. So going back to that original concept of the only secret to Toyota is an attitude towards learning. So if we need to lead with this attitude towards learning, this is how we do it. And so there are a few really important things along this. So about setting direction is about providing that direction, challenge, or target, both for the outcomes that we need, but also for the culture that we want too. And Mr. Yoshino talks about leaders need to set seemingly impossible targets or move us towards a challenge that we don't know how to achieve yet. And a gap that I see often in Western companies is that we are a little timid in wanting to really set challenges that we don't currently have the answer to or feel like we can probably get there because we don't have this true attitude or culture that supports learning and failing our way forward. And Mr. Yoshino goes on to say, we need to do this based on what is needed, not just what we think is achievable. So really, where do we need to go? And what do our employees need? What do our customers need? And at the input of that, we will be a thriving company. The second is providing support. And this is about creating the conditions for learning and continuous improvement. And there's so much that we can talk about this, but the real important point of this is it's making the shift from us as leaders being the expert, doing all the doing, owning the thinking, versus supporting and developing other people to understand the process of the thinking and teaching them the process so that they can make processes better, so that they can improve. And this is it for those of you who are able to see the slides, and you can go and visit them later if you're listening to this. There's a picture of a hanko or a stamp or what we might call a signature. In Japan, it actually is a stamp rather than someone's actual written signature. And this is Mr. Yoshino's hanko on John Shook's very first A3, his very first document that he was presenting, sharing the thinking he had around a problem he had been assigned, one of those challenges he'd been assigned. And what this signature, this hanko signified, is that Mr. Yoshino had overseen the process and coached John through the process of going through problem solving and making this operational problem better or making progress on solving that problem rather than him doing it himself. And this is such a critical shift for us to how do we really create the conditions and create the support and coach and develop people to be able to have the capability and confidence to solve problems. And the third part of a leader's purpose is developing yourself and seeing ourselves all as business conditions that require improvement. So if we want those results, we too have to focus on ourselves as the people, as the inputs to the outputs that we want. And I see four key behaviors that we can really focus on in being able to create an organization of continuous improvement and close gaps that we see in our processes in our organizations. We also need to close the gaps in our own actions and behaviors. And there are four key ones, and this all links back to what is talked about in the Shingo model as well, about what the behaviors that leaders can take that really, really foster this culture of learning and continuous improvement. It's about going to see, going to Gemba, going to the place the work actually happens, both to check on process and to show that you care about people. And this is something Mr. Yoshino talked so much about, and I described throughout the book, Learning to Lead, Leading to Learn. Asking questions more effectively, not just telling our answer or idea, really cultivating curiosity so that we're helping other people learn and think. Pausing, slowing down, not just being reactive, and giving space for people to experiment and try and learn. And then studying and reflecting. This is what is also known as hansei, self-reflection, but also the study or the check part of the PDSA or the PDCA cycle. And the thing that we often just rush right through because we feel the sense of urgency that we have to do. And again, this is where we get stuck on focusing on the results in the short time and the shareholder value. We need to build in more time for the study and the reflection. This is where the learning happens and that wisdom's created and the continuous improvement really is accelerated. And we think about, and I've been spending some time really thinking about how do these comments about a leader's purpose, about setting direction, providing support, and developing ourselves also align with everything that's fundamental in the Shingo model and the Shingo principles, because they are all the essence about how we create these high-performing continuous improvement cultures. And we think about setting direction is really linked about enterprise alignment. How do we create both that constancy of purpose? So the true purpose of the organization about developing people so we can make the thing, create the value for our customers and serve your customers. So, right. And then how do we think systemically about how we do that and make the challenges bigger than we know how to do right now, but align everyone on that direction we need to go, both for culture and for value for our customers. Providing support is about teaching people and giving them the skills and the space to be able to create continuous improvement in the organization. So teaching them and cultivating this knowledge in them about how to do all these elements that are embedded in creating better processes that improve the work. It was interesting that Mr. Toyota also said that in Japanese, which I hadn't realized before, and I was studying a lot of Japanese when I lived in Japan, was that the word for easy is also fun. So if we can continuously improve and make the work easier and help people make the work easier, it's going to be more fun as well. So we all both make the work better, but we make the environment better too. And then developing yourself is really aligned with these core cultural enablers about how do we lead with humility to know that we too are conditions that require improvement and that how we show up needs to embody respect for every individual. Or as I learned from Mr. Yoshino and others, that the concept of respect for people actually in Japanese is translated to respect for humanity or holding precious what it means to be human. So we need to develop ourselves and stay connected with that heart, provide support so people can continuously improve and set the direction so that we're aligned on value and purpose. Mr. Toyota too, just a few days ago, said something to a few hundred executives. And he said, in reflection, he knows it's his job to make decisions and take responsibility. This again is about setting the direction. This is the telling, where do we need to go? What are the challenges we need to achieve? What is our purpose and how do we stay connected with that constancy of purpose? And then taking responsibility to provide support. And when mistakes happen, to acknowledge them like he was doing in these meetings as well recently. And this goes back to Mr. Yoshino's experience going full circle here. Not only did his managers not blame him, not yell at him. Instead, they went over actually and did the behaviors of gaps. They went to go see. They asked what was the process. They paused instead of being reactive. And then they studied and adjust and said, how can we do something different and make this mistake proof this for the future? But he did something even more. The manager turned to Mr. Yoshino and said, thank you. Thank you for making this mistake. Just like Mr. Toyota said, it's his responsibility when mistakes happen, taking the responsibility. It is our responsibility as managers to create the conditions for you to be successful. And your mistake has highlighted that we have an opportunity to improve this as well. What a total shift if we can show up in this way and embracing this and seeing our role, not just to focus on the outcomes and the results, but go back to this core purpose, creating the conditions where people thrive, to use their thinking and their minds to be able to continuously innovate and create better value for the customers. This is where the real purpose of our organizations needs to be and our purpose for our organizations. We make people so we can make things or the service or the product, whatever it is, the value for our customers. Those two are so linked together. And if we can get back to that essence, we will be able to achieve so much more. So this goes through the whole story from Toyota's 40 years from the 60s to the early 2000s from my book and the stories from Mr. Yoshino's real live experiences at Toyota. And it's still happening today. It requires our constant attention and how we continuously improve and create this organization. I'm looking forward to having some more conversations with you all and invite you to connect with me so we can continue to have dialogue even after this webinar as well. You can connect with me on LinkedIn or my website, kbjanderson.com. And of course, I have a new podcast, Chain of Learning. So please go check it out. And I look forward to the conversations and your questions here today.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Katie. That was so good. I know I feel inspired. So I hope that others did as well.
I encourage everyone to go and read some of those articles. If you go to the PDF, we have the link to them. You can also go to the Toyota Times to read the details of Mr. Toyota's speech. There's actually two speeches. It's really quite profound, all the things he said, and looking back at where the gaps have gone wrong with Toyota and how they're course correcting, and really coming back to that constancy of purpose and how it's so easy to lose sight of it. So when we focus on those results, the shareholder value or the profits, we can sort of lose our way. So how do we come back to that core purpose?
Wonderful. Okay, so first question, how can we spread a Hansei culture when the top management doesn't spread this mindset? How can we have influence and impact as an individual contributor to make things progress?
Yeah, so that's, I get this question a lot, and I've been challenged in my past times as well. It can be hard when the leaders above us aren't already in that mindset themselves, but I always say we have to, show up and develop ourselves first. So how can you demonstrate more Hansei for yourself and for your team, and creating spaces where you're asking a few more questions that invite some Hansei and reflection for others, others too. So it can be little bit by little bit as well, but the more you can create that space or pause, or even just ask one question that might get people to think a little bit more deeply, that is a power that you have as that independent contributor, because you're seeing things in a different perspective.
Sharon asks, I was surprised to hear about the belt tightening every 20 years. Do you have any insight on the cause of the drift?
Well, I've talked about that with Mr. Yoshino as well. So, we were having conversations over years, and then decided to work on this book together, which ended up going deep into his reflections on his whole time at Toyota. And one of the things that we talked about was it's really this generational, something happens generationally, right? And so as more people are coming into an organization and leaders are aging out, because this happens even at Toyota, they generally have more lifetime employment. It's easy to lose sight of that sort of the original purpose and the focus. So again, like Toyota won the Deming Award in the late 60s. And so then it was, almost into the early 1980s where they were retightening the belt with that first time. And so it's really just leaders also having to take that intentional focus on saying, what is the culture that we want? And how are we demonstrating these behaviors, not only ourselves, but making sure that we're teaching and modeling that for people as well. So I think it's more of a generational thing. The 20 years is sort of that time where new leaders are coming in, and maybe the ones that were really focused on it are aging out or retiring. So we have to keep that constant focus, even if we're Toyota, right?
Absolutely. Always improving.
Yep.
Last question for today. Thank you for the overview. Can you also explain the tools and techniques of Lean?
Well,
I'm not sure we have enough time.
I don't know. Yeah, in 1 minute, I can't do that. But I would go back to the quote that I said, that the only secret to Toyota is its attitude towards learning. So all the tools, if you go back to all the tools and the techniques, they're about creating the conditions for learning and improvement. So even like a Kanban system, it's about how are we making visible and seeing flow and the connection, how can we keep improving that? And the tool of an A3 is about how are we creating visibility for learning? How are we coaching and developing other people? How are we really being effective on solving problems? So everything goes back to how are we learning and improving? And the tools are a mechanism that enable that, if applied correctly and with that mindset, and not just trying to do a tool and check the box that I use the tool, but using with an attitude towards learning.
Absolutely. And I'll just add a little bit to that as well. If you would like to learn more about tools and systems and principles and how they connect, check out the Shingo Model. It'll help you as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
And Katie, thank you so much. For those of you that are interested, Katie will be keynoting at this year's conference, and I'm sure she'll have more time to spend on the topic and be able to answer questions as well. So please check that out, shingo.org/events, and you can learn more. And thank you. We'll see you again next time.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.